Welcome. In this video, we will look at form design with the PowerBasic Windows Compiler. This will be our first video in the PowerBasic Windows Compiler. Much of the code we're going to build within this compiler is based upon the previous 18 videos where we worked with the PowerBasic Console Compiler. You'll find the IDE, the Integrated Development Environment, to be very similar to that of the Console Compiler. To create a new program, we select from the first icon on the toolbar, which gives us a number of options. The first option allows us to build dynamic linked libraries, which we haven't done under the Console Compiler. The next one is the generic PB program, which is what we're going to be doing now. So if we pick that from the list, we'll get the skeleton of a PowerBasic program, which if you'd looked at the previous videos, you'll see is exactly the same as the Console Compiler. All we're going to do here is a simple hello world. A simple message box will display a message box on the screen. The message box can be written either as a statement, which it is here, or as a function returning a value. If we run this now, and we'll call this hello world, and if we run this program now, it will display a small message box on the screen that says hello world. And hitting on the OK will terminate the program. There is only one line of code in this program, so since there's no code following this line of code, the program ends. Now, with the Windows compiler, one of the functions you want to do in here is to create forms so that you can interact with your program. The console compiler, which you've seen in the previous videos, was purely sending information out to the console. And although you can grab information from the console that a user types in, most of those type of programs will be done in the Windows compiler. So, if we were to create our first form, there are basically two ways of creating forms in the Windows compiler. One is using the dynamic dialog tools, and the other is a lower level one where you're creating the windows from scratch. Today we're going to be covering dynamic dialog tools. If we go up to the menu, you'll see that there's a PowerBasic Forms entry on the Tools menu. If we click on that, it will bring up a message to say that this particular application was not created using PowerBasic Forms, which it wasn't. So if we say yes, it will prepare our form for first use. Now the form designer, while being fairly basic, is adequate for basic forms. We click on the first icon, it gives us a very basic window which we can resize to our selection. Now, before we do anything in here, we'll go through the toolbar. In the toolbar, there are a number of things we can do. There's a test dialog switch on the toolbar to allow us to test a dialog before we go back to our main program. If we double click on the dialog itself, it will bring up a properties box to tell us basic information. You can name the dialog. So we can put a caption on the dialog. And we can give it a name. You can use the caption just by clicking on the little button at the side, or you can explicitly name the dialog. And once you hit OK, it puts the title at the top of the dialog. Now the other thing we haven't done is we haven't looked at styles. Now these may look a little intimidating, but you'll get your head around them fairly quickly. There are some basic ones you want to set for every dialog. For example, caption, system menu, and centered. We'll cover the minimize and maximize options later. If we set these, it gives us an X at the top of the dialog, and if we click to test our dialog, this will show how our dialog will actually show with an X at the top, which we can close. It's always important to give the user a method for getting out of a dialog. So what can we do in a dialog? Well, over here there is a toolbox which you can actually put things on. If we want to put a button on the dialog, we can quite happily put a button in. If you double click on the button, it gives you the options for what you can do with the button. Well, let's call this exit. And on the drop down, there are a number of basic standard values, which these are constants, as you'll see, since they're preceded with the percentage sign. So we'll set this one to be abort. And there's a button. Now, if we want some text to appear on the screen, we can set some text. Now, when you refer to the text, you refer to it by its name. So if we go by the labeling, we'll call this one title. And it automatically sets a value for it inside the system. All Windows applications work internally on the values rather than names. You can pick the system colors for background and foreground, or if you wish to highlight it, you can pick a different color. So let's try that. And there is our text. Now you may want to make the text bigger or smaller, but this is the standard text at the moment, so we'll go for that to do our very first basic dialog. Now, if we save this now, and we'll overwrite our Hello World file, this is our form imported into the HelloWorld.bas file. Now, you'll see that it has actually added a fair amount of text to our code. Anything between PBForms tags, you should be wary about amending. Now, in here, it has put in a number of include files that are necessary for handling our form. I'll come back to them in a moment. It's created some constants, some declarations, and your main code is in here. Now, we'll cover these one at a time. If you look up to the top of the program, it's put some text in here to say that this is a PBForms program. It's important to leave that in there because PBForms uses that to work out where it is. We've still got the compile.exe, we've still got the dimension all to make sure all variables are dimensioned. Inside this block of text, we have the PBForms includes. It automatically creates a resource file for you, and it sets a constant called use macros. Use macros in this case is used to define what happens inside the Windows 32 API. We briefly touched on this in previous videos, but basically the Windows 32 API includes many, many routines and entry points into the main Windows system itself. The once predicate inside after the include is designed so that sometimes you'll find libraries actually reference other libraries which have already been included. So putting in include once means it will only ever include it once. If you didn't put that in, it would possibly error to say that you were trying to include code already in there. Normally, you won't have to touch these. These will go in with PBForms. The constants, you can create your own constants after the PBForms own constants, but these have actually defined and used within the PBForms dialog designer. The declarations, it will automatically create these for you, although they're not actually necessary because when you compile, it will create them anyway. Now, which takes us to the main code function, the function which starts off the program, the pbmain. There are basically two lines of code in here. One to initialize the controls on pbforms, which pbforms puts in for you, and the second one is calling this function, show dialog first dialog, with a single parameter, which is basically a constant with a value of 0 for the handle of the desktop. Now, if we have a look at that particular function in here, show first dialog, this is what the forms tool has actually done for you. It has basically created all the code necessary to display the form on screen. If we step through this, here's the parameter coming in, which is basically the parent, which is the desktop. Your application is a child of the desktop. We're setting a local variable to be the handle for your dialog. We're using the dialog new command to instruct the dynamic dialog tools to create a new dialog. The parameters in that are basically the title of the dialog, its position on the screen in X and Y coordinates, and its width and height on the screen. The other parameters in here are all constants, which are basically the styles which you set inside the Forms Designer. Then we're doing things like adding a button, which is our exit button, again X and Y coordinates, width and height. We're adding a label, and again the title of the label and its coordinates on screen, its width and height. And we're setting the color, again, of the same label to be blue. Blue foreground and standard background colors. Now, if you amend any of the code inside these two tags, the PDForms begin and end, you risk breaking what's happening inside the Forms Designer. If you put your own code in here, the Forms Designer, if you go back into it, may overwrite it. So if you need to put any code after this, like add any custom controls like buttons or labels or anything like that, that may well be dynamic, put it after the PBForms end. The command at the bottom here is the command to actually show the dialog. Dialogs can be shown in one of two ways. They can be shown modally or modeless. A modal dialog is one which will appear on the screen and will remain on the screen constantly until the user actually does something, either closes a dialog or clicks on a button. A modeless dialog is one which, while it displays on the screen, it will instantly move on to the next line of code. The parameters in here, this is basically a pointer towards the function which is your event handler for your dialog. Now, in theory, you can set an event handler for each control individually, which in rare cases you may wish to do, but normally you would set an event handler for the dialog itself, which is in itself a function. And you're basically waiting inside here, and you're going to return from that function with a value. Now, if we look at the event handler, the callback for this form, which is this one here, there we go. Again, it's a function, but it's preceded with the word callback to indicate basically it's a callback function. This is your event handler. Now, in here, the Forms Designer has written a lot of the code for you. There are a number of event types. For example, when the dialog is initialized, when it's activated, and when something is happening on one of the controls. Now, down here we have this idea bot. Remember when we placed the button on the screen? We basically gave it a value of idea bot. So in here, this is a test to see if the button has been clicked or has been selected by default. In this case, it's just going to throw a message up. So if we run this program now, here we go, here's our dialog on the screen. It's put our title on the dialog, our label, and our button. And again, if we click on the button, it will throw a message box up to say basically what we've told it to say. Now, the only way out of this dialog at the moment is to click the X at the top right hand corner. If we wanted to end the dialog when you hit exit, we would need to end the dialog. The dialog end command will end any dialog you have currently got loaded, and it needs to know what the handle to the dialog is. Since we're in a callback event handler, the cb.hndl is the handle of the dialog you happen to be in, whatever one that is. So if we run that program now, it would compile, it would bring our dialog up on the screen, and hitting the exit button would exit the program. It exits the program because it's closing the dialog, and when we go back to this is a dialog, and there's no operative line of code after that. So the program finishes. You could, of course, put another dialog after here, or some other command, or some cleanup function to close up after your program, perhaps writing to a log file. Now, from our original program, this is the debris that the forms has discarded, so we can erase this because we don't need it anymore. So that is a very simple dialog application using dynamic dialog tools. All it does is display a dialog on the screen and waits for something to happen. The only event we've got going is the exit event. Now, what we can do on the exit one is if we have a look at the dialog designer, what we have in there is an unconditional exit from the application. Now, we may wish to do something a little more intelligent than that. We might want to put a message to the user to say, are you sure you want to exit? So we're going to run this as a function, and we want to give the user some questions. On the message box, there are a number of options. If we're looking for something for yes, no, then this is the constant we're interested in. So we'll copy that. And we'll put that on the screen. Now we can put a conditional on this. Just so we can see what we're doing, let's fold that round. Now, what we're doing here is we're displaying a message box on screen asking, are you sure? We're giving the user two buttons on the screen, yes and no. If they actually have selected yes, then we end the dialogue. If they have not selected yes, if they selected no instead, then we do not end the dialogue. So if we run that program now, click and exit, we ask them, are they sure? If they say no, the dialogue remains on screen. If they say yes, the dialog closes and the program finishes because that's the last line of code. This is a very short introduction to what we can do with dialogs. We will cover these in more detail in later videos. Thank you for watching.